I've had my 911 for just over a month now. Time is flying. And I've done just over 2,000 miles, so I'm free to rev it all the way to the red line these days. I'm just still completely obsessed with this car. In fact, I've driven it every single day I've owned it, and I think I've washed it pretty much every single day. I've certainly vacuumed it every single day. I'm spending a lot of time with this little vehicle, which is great. Considering the amount of money you spend on these things, you've got to love it. And yeah, I think this is the car that I've been the most obsessed with in my entire life. Well, maybe my very first car, I just was obsessed with that as well. I thought it was the coolest car ever. My very first car, for those of you that are interested, was a Ford Laser Gear, it was a second-hand car, it was a 1989. I just thought it was the fastest thing on the road. It was a 1.6 naturally aspirated. I think it had 105 horsepower. It was awesome. Anyway, back to the 911, which is also awesome. I'm learning something new about this car every single day. In fact, I learned a very important lesson yesterday. I took a trip with Tui out to have some lunch with some friends, and on the way back I was getting some gas, and while I was getting some gas I heard a click and I look around and find that I'm locked out of my own car. Yes, Tui had stepped on the all doors lock button. She'd also stepped on the hazard flasher lights, which she often does, and the keys were still in the car. So for 40 minutes I was trying to coax Tui to step back on that button again. I was at the point of ringing the Porsche people to come and get me, or my neighbour to get my spare keys for my car, but in the end, one of the bystanders, and there were quite a few bystanders, it seems that there's nothing more amusing than seeing the dick in his Porsche being locked out by his own dog. So a lot of people were standing around taking photographs and trying to help, and in the end a tow truck driver that happened to be there managed to coax Tui to step on the button and back in the car again. So, lesson learned, do not leave Tui and the keys in the car at the same time. As I said, I'm discovering new things every day. There's so many little touches in these 991.2s that they've updated. There was nothing wrong with the 991.1s, but they've gone and thought through a few little things, and yeah, I'm discovering stuff every day. One of the things that, of course, this being a turbocharged engine now, we now get a little turbo symbol like the turbo and the Turbo S used to have. And I'll demonstrate that if I change down, put my foot down, you can see it shows the boost pressure there. But in the multifunction display, there's a lot of new options, and maybe I'll do a separate video on that. But yeah, just to go through the multifunction display, this one here is a completely programmable display that you can put anything on here, but I like having the turbo pressure and the temperatures, so it shows an exact temperature so I can see how the car's warming up. And of course the oil pressure. I like having the oil pressure on there because that moves around a lot. The next display is the G-forces. I don't know that anyone ever uses that, but I guess it's a cool display, and you can set it to tell you what the max G-forces were. If you have the manual transmission like me, you get the gear shift assist, which basically tells you what gear you're in and helps you with upshifting. I'll demonstrate that if I put my foot down here. As you head towards the red line, you get that little display telling you, change up, change up. It's pretty cool. The next one is the Sport Chrono feature, which is the stopwatch. Has lots of lap times as well, and it works with the little stopwatch that's up on the dashboard there. Next one is, this is for the all-wheel drive cars. This is another update with the 991.2. They've improved the all-wheel drive system. It's a lot faster at engaging the front wheels than the old system was. And you notice that in the snow that it snaps to the front wheels a lot more quickly than the old all-wheel drive system did. Not that they were bad in the past, but yeah, it's a noticeable improvement with the four-wheel drive system. And as you can see here, it's mostly sitting rear bias, and it tries to be a rear-wheel drive car most of the time. But yeah, as soon as you start getting the rear end out, it pushes that torque to the front to correct you. Next is the tire pressure monitor. I've been pretty lucky with this car. It sits pretty solidly on the right pressures all the time. And then there's the trip computer. And as you can see on the trip computer down here, my average fuel consumption has been a terrible 17.6 miles per the gallon. And that's mostly because I'm driving around sliding in the snow and, you know, putting my foot to the ground and not doing any economical highway cruising at this time. So I'm getting terrible miles to the gallon. And also, I have a manual transmission. One of the big downsides of the manual transmission is you're just never going to be as careful with the upshifts and diligent with getting it into that seventh gear as you would if you had the PDK. So PDK drivers are luckily seeing high 20s, even low 30s in their cars, whereas us manual transmissions, you're lucky to see 20s, mid 20s. And then finally, navigation. And if you're willing to pay a small fee for the data package, you can get this nice Google Maps navigation. And then the audio and phone screen. So that's what that little multifunction display does now. And there's a lot of little updates in there with this new version. So speaking of the manual transmission, I am so pleased I got it. I understand it's not for everyone. Obviously the PDK is a lot more popular and I'm not gonna run down the PDK. It is an excellent, excellent transmission. It does make the car faster. It does make the car easier to drive in heavy traffic. And of course you get the launch control, a better fuel economy. PDK is a wonderful thing. But for me, having the manual transmission has transformed the ownership of this car. I feel a lot more connected to the car and I'm getting very used to having the manual transmission, to the point that when I get in my Golf now, I'm going for the non-existent clutch pedal in it. For the first couple of days, I was sort of missing getting the gear changes wrong, but I've got it all sorted now. Seven gears is a lot of gears to get used to the shift pattern, but it's a light clutch and the gearbox is tight and predictable, a little notchy. It is the best manual transmission I've ever driven, and it really transforms how I drive this car and my enjoyment of the car. As for the engine, well, of course, when they changed to the turbocharged engine, there were so many people going, this is the end of the world. And of course, we're all gonna miss the responsiveness and sound of the naturally aspirated engine. But of course, this new turbocharged engine also sounds glorious and has its own benefits. You know, the flexibility of that torque makes this a much easier car to drive. You know, don't get me wrong, I love the 3.8 naturally aspirated engine. I loved how it built the torque through the rev range. I loved how it sounded. But this car has its own character with this engine that, you know, I'm equally happy with. In fact, it's almost too powerful. I know, crazy talk. How could you say something's too powerful, Nick? The problem is that when you get so much power, it's a little hard to push the engine. So it becomes a little less fun. And what I mean by that is, you know, I got to drive the 370 horsepower, the engine down from this, the base model engine the other day. And what a fun engine that is. You just have to push it a little harder, and having smaller turbochargers, it's a little more reactive. You know, I honestly think the base model Carrera these days is the most fun 911. Sure, a GT3 is the most fun on a track, but it's not a fun car to drive day to day. I think the base model Carrera 2 is actually the most fun car in the range at the moment. The previous model base Carrera was a little underpowered, but with the new turbocharged engines and those very small turbochargers, it's a very reactive engine. But I love the engine in this as well. I do push it a lot and I find myself going a little faster than I should in many circumstances. And I don't think I need any more power. In fact, whenever I've driven a turbo or a turbo S, you just never get to use all that power, and so it becomes a little boring. It's nice to be able to push your car. You know, that's the fun of driving a sports car, is trying to take it to the edge or trying to take it to the red line as often as you can. And speaking of drivability, the biggest change I found with this car is how much more comfortable and usable it is than my old 991.1. And a big part of that is the 18-way seats, as I mentioned before. I find them so much more comfortable than the 14-way. I really had about a 1 hour limit of driving my old car, whereas this car I'm happy to drive 2 or 3 hours and still be completely comfortable. It is definitely not just the Sport Tex. The Sport Tex makes a big difference. I love the Sport Tex because it looks so great. It adds extra grip that you don't get with the leather. And it's breathable. You don't sweat with these seats. But of course, the cushioning is just softer on these 18-ways. I know a lot of people are arguing with me about this, but go into a dealership and put your hand on the seats. You'll see what I'm talking about. It's not just the Sport Tex that makes it more comfortable. It is definitely the 18-ways, if your body fits them. You know, not everybody can fit into an 18-way seat, but if you can, they're well worth getting. But you know, one of the biggest surprises I've got in this car has been the stereo system. Not really something people were that worried about in a 911. But I was kind of bracing myself for disappointment because the Bose stereo system in the 991.1s was average at best. Even my Burmeister that I got in the previous one, I really didn't feel it was worth the $5,200 I spent. So this time I just got the Bose and thought I'd live with it. And when I got it, I found that it sounds a lot better than I expected. So I actually wrote to the Porsche people to find out what's going on. And it turns out it's been completely revamped. It wasn't just my imagination. It's all new speakers, all new amplifiers, all new Logic unit, and they've substantially increased the size of the speakers in the rear. So you're now getting sound from the rear, which you didn't used to in the past. So the gap between the Bose and the Burmeister has been decreased substantially. You know, I've never been a big fan of Bose stereo systems, whether they're home or in the car or whatever, because I've never found that they've been very good at the high ends and the low ends. But this system has been great. And at first I just thought it was my imagination, but the more I use it, the more I'm impressed with it. So yeah, get the Bose system. It's far, far better than the Bose system that was in the 991.1. I don't know what made them make that change, but I'm glad that they did because yeah, it's a big improvement. Poor William is tortured with my terrible 80s music night and day. So overall, I'm just delighted with the configuration I got. You know, normally after a month of ownership, I'm starting to think, oh, I wish I'd got this or I wish I got that. But no, so far, this configuration has been just perfect. And a big part of that is because it's really a redo car. You know, I had my 991.1 and there was a lot of options on there that I didn't really care for and I wish that I'd changed. And I got to do that in this car. So this car has been perfect configuration for me. The one caveat I'd say on that is right now, of course, I'm loving having an all-wheel drive car. I drive this car every day, whether it's sunny or raining or blizzard, and all-wheel drive is making that possible for me, and I'm really enjoying having the all-wheel drive. Ask me again in 3 months' time, when it's summer and dry, and I'm not going to be so enthusiastic about the all-wheel drive. You know, all-wheel drive does suck a little bit of the joy out of these cars in dry weather because you have so much trouble getting that rear end out, and it's not really so much of a sports car then. It's still, you know, the all-wheel drive certainly improves the performance, but it decreases the fun in my mind anyway. But for now, loving the all-wheel drive, loving the configuration overall. And so far, there's been absolutely no damage to the car. Even though I drive it in all weather conditions, it stood up great to the winter here. A big part of that, of course, is that I've got the clear bra over the entire car, so I'm pretty comfortable with driving it, even in harsh blizzard conditions. And looking underneath the car, you know, the splash plates all still in place. In fact, there's just no noticeable damage to the car at all, which is great. It's holding up great. Not to say that I don't have a few problems. In fact, I have three very small problems. These problems are not affecting my enjoyment of the car, and they've all been there since new. The first one is a small trim problem with the leather. I actually noticed it the day that I picked it up, and I'm going to get the dealer to fix it when it goes in for its next service. It's just a little bit of leather that hasn't been stuck down here in the footwell. It's just a tiny little inconsistency, not a big deal. Just needs to be glued. I'd do it myself, but I think it's better if the dealer does it. The next one's an odd one. The 991.2 comes standard with voice control. It was an option in the previous model, but in my car, it doesn't work. That is, you press the little voice control button on the end of the indicator stalk, and it's meant to be able to take navigation commands and a few things like that. But in my car, it says speech operation not available. It's basically just like every other female in my life, just not willing to listen. The dealer's not sure why that isn't working. They're going to look at it again next time I get it serviced. They think it's a software issue, so they're going to reload some software and hopefully that fixes that problem. And the third issue is really the only issue that's annoying me, and that is the home link system, which is these three little programmable buttons up the top here, which you can program your remote control door opener to. I've programmed my two garage doors to it, and it works most days, but every now and then, maybe once a week or twice a week, it just doesn't work at all. It won't open either garage door. I don't know why. And what's annoying about this problem, of course, is that I don't think they're ever going to fix that. You know, it's one of those on and off problems. And when you take it into the dealership, of course, it's going to work the day you take it in. So apart from having video evidence that it doesn't work, there's really nothing I can do. So I don't know if it's a broken aerial or the little light still comes on, it just won't open the garage doors. And then the next day, it opens it perfectly fine. So I don't know. So it means I have to carry around my other garage door opener, which is a little annoying, but really not a big deal. So one of the common questions I've been getting is the running cost so far on my 911. Well, it's really just been the cost of fuel. There's been no maintenance costs yet, and apart from me putting the clear bra on and the dash cam in, there's been no other actual costs. Oh, insurance. Actually, insurance is an interesting one. You'll like this. Insurance for this car per year with maxed out coverage is only $738. That's through my insurance company, Progressive. And I was a bit shocked to get that bill because it's lower than my Golf S. My 2013 Golf S is $950 to insure a year with maxed out coverage. Why is my $136,000 Porsche 911 less than my Golf? Well, I actually wrote to the insurance assessor to find that out because I thought it might be a mistake. Not that you should look a gift horse in the mouth, but I was interested to see why it was, because I remember with my last Porsche 911, I also had pretty low premiums. And they actually wrote back. It was an interesting letter. They said it just comes down to the math of it. Even though the car's worth so much more, Porsches in general, Porsche 911s in general, very rarely are in accidents, and they very rarely get stolen. And where I live, there's virtually no car crime, and it's a nice area, and I have a very good credit rating. You know, they ran it all through, and well, I should get lower premiums on my Golf as well. It's just the nature of 911s. They apparently 911 owners look after their cars, and they're very, very rarely have any claims for them, and so the premiums are lower. So that's great. So I'll be interested to hear in the comments, anyone else that's got a 911, are your premiums this low as well? Yeah, it's great news. You'd think for such an expensive car, your premiums would be a lot higher, but so far, my premiums are a bargain. So good news. Good news for anyone thinking of getting a 911. You don't have to pay a lot in insurance. You probably have to pay a lot in taxes, but not in insurance. Anyway, that's about it for this video. As I said, I've got a bunch more videos on this car coming up, and I'm just loving, adoring, obsessing about this car every day, which is great. You know, it's the way it should be. Anyway, William and I thank you for watching as always. We really appreciate your support on my channel, and we'll see you in the next video. Thanks everyone. Bye then.